I thought I'd be a teacher. I was gonna go to McMaster University and be a teacher. And that was my plan. And then when I was cutting the lawn for a neighbor, one day there was a man there who was painting their house, and he had stickers all over his car that had Bible verses. So I was like, oh, this is gonna be great. He shared with me how his life had changed. He'd been a heller, and a girl invited him to church, and he heard about Jesus. And as he shared the gospel that I'm a sinner like everybody else, and I need a savior, and Jesus is the only one. And the funny thing is, I had actually joined the church, went through confirmation classes, maybe a few months before that, and but I'd never really heard that phrase, or I'll say the Spirit had not convicted me of that phrase, that I am a sinner. I thought I was good enough. By human standards, I was, in a sense. I was a good boy, based on the Canadians, but that really stuck out to me. And so he explained that if you really want to have a living faith, you need to confess your sin and surrender to Jesus as Savior and Lord. And here we were. I was in, going to summer of grade 9, and we were in a garage, and he said, well, do you want to pray right now? I was like, oh, okay. And so he led me through a prayer. He gave me a little booklet to read, and I went home. You know, in God's providence, nobody was home at lunchtime. And I remember making the lunch, and there, I put a little pamphlet on the counter and sat down in the kitchen. And then I got up and picked it up and started reading through this little pamphlet. Explains that Jesus is my personal savior. I didn't know what either term meant. What do you mean he's my personal savior? Right? That he has saved me from the penalty of my sins, which is eternal separation from God. And he's personal when I ask him to be my savior. And you know, so in that little lunchtime, reading that booklet alone and just thinking through what I'd done, I was like, okay, I'll try it. And as I said before, I wanted to be a high school teacher, and I fully planned to go to McMaster University. And a friend of mine called me one night and said he was gonna go to Bible school for a year. I said, why don't we go together? I was like, well, I'd never even thought of it. In God's providence and in timing, it was like he just gave me the desire. I went, you know what? Yeah, let's go for a year for my own personal growth. And so I changed directions, went to Tyndale University College and Seminary for 1 year. And then when that was done, I was like, that was pretty good. I should go to Mac. But then, no, you know what? I wasn't sure now why I was gonna go to Mac. So I thought, why don't I go back to Bible school? And get a degree and finish it. And again, somewhere in the second year, I was like, you know what? I think God wants me to be a youth pastor. And so I changed my degree course again, and God just kept working with me. I had no idea I was gonna be a pastor, and finished and became a youth pastor, and God has kept moving. I'm the most surprised person of all that I'm in the ministry today. And so are all my teachers, by the way, too. And so I've been a youth pastor, an associate pastor, a solo pastor, and now a lead pastor. And I'm just amazed as I see how God worked all that out, beginning in that garage, a young teenager, you know, just finished grade 9, and how he's led. I'm just thrilled, just grateful to God for that. You know, in everybody's life, there is some rain. And so, of course, I've had it too. My mother died, as it were, prematurely when I was in my 30s. My parents eventually totally separated, that kind of thing. And just, sure, low times with my own view of myself, self-worth, disappointments in ministry, you know, at times struggles with marriage too. And, you know, when the movie The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe came out by C.S. Lewis. And I've been so captivated by Aslan and just the picture of Aslan. More than once, at times when I meet with the Lord on those kind of low times in my life, there are times I go, Lord, I don't really feel like talking today. And so I just want to go for a ride. And so I actually picture myself riding on Aslan's back and know that's the Lord carrying me. And there's days when that's very precious. I don't feel like praying through all the list of all the typical things and have that time alone with him. So that's kind of been a dear picture for me.
So, Bill, do you love him?
You know what? That's a great question. Do I love the Lord? One of my favorite definitions of the word love is to desire or delight in someone. And I'm more amazed at the fact that God loves me, that he desires to be with me and delights being in my presence. And so I use the word sparingly if I say I love the Lord, because I feel like I don't want to sound like a typical, here we go, Christianese. But I would say the Lord loves me more than I love him, but I'm so grateful for it and am striving to equal, even though I can't, strive to love him and back the way he loves me.